Hello, my name is Mario. Welcome to another Software Architecture in Go video. In today's episode, I'm going to be talking about Architecture Decision Records, also known as ADRs. So what is an architectural decision? An architectural decision is a design decision that addresses architecturally significant requirements that are perceived as hard to make and or costly to change. For example, migrating between different software architectures, monolith to microservice, migrating from different data stores, relational database, NoSQL, replacing a programming language, Go to Java, or even thinking of the transport or the communication method that you're going to be using, for example, gRPC to JSON over HTTP. Those will be decisions that you shouldn't take lightly, and you should be thinking well and before making them, otherwise it will be harder to go back and fix the problem that you introduced by making those decisions in the first place. So Neil Ford and Mark Richards wrote a book called Fundamentals of Software Architecture, which I highly recommend. It's published by O'Reilly and it was published in 2020. They introduce this concept of architectural design records that describe why those are more important than how those are implemented. And this is based on a gentleman that wrote, came up with this idea called Michael Nygard. And he said that he would like to keep a collection of records for architecturally significant decisions that affect the structure, non-functional characteristics, or our attributes, dependencies, interfaces, or construction techniques. So, how can we structure those architecture decision records? Everything begins with a title. A title should be sequential, and it has to be concrete. For example, ADR1, migrate to the cloud. The title comes first, next comes the status. The status has four values, which will be a proposed when everything begins. There is an accepted status, and finally there is a superseded or supersedes status that indicates that the current ADR, it was either replacing one that already exists or is being replaced by another one that is coming afterwards. For example, it could be an accepted, like I said, supersedes ADR1, assuming that now we're talking about an ADR 2 or 3 or whatever the case may be. There is a context, and the context indicates what should be doing, why are we doing it in the first place. For example, if we take the initial example that when we were talking about the title, if we're thinking about migrating to the cloud, well, operating costs are too much. Our services are not elastic. Obviously, we need to give more than that. Ideally, when we're writing our ADR, it has to be from 1 to 2 pages, not too long. It doesn't have to be a book or an essay, but it has to be something enough to make it available, if we have to probably our stakeholders, our managers, or even our team. That's really important to keep in mind. Next will be a decision, which clearly indicates what are we going to be doing. Either we're going to be following it through with the idea that we originally had, or we are going to be abandoning it, or what specifically we are going to be doing. In this case, again, using the example of migrating to the cloud, I'm saying I evaluated GCP, Azure, and AWS, and we are migrating to AWS because XYZ, whatever decisions we made at that point. Now, what are the consequences? The consequences could be something positive, negative, or affecting our abilities. A positive example would be, well, the costs are going to be reduced by 30%, just to say a number. The negative will be that, hey, the databases that we're using is not supported by AWS, therefore we need to migrate it to whatever AWS supports. And a change in the abilities will be, well, scalability now is improved because handling auto-scaling in AWS is significantly easier. Now, what are some tips for writing ADRs? The tips that I can recommend you is you don't have to use a tool. I'm going to be leaving in the description of this video a few tools that you can use if you want to. I personally just like to use in my editor, going directly. I'm going to define everything as I need. I don't use a CLI or anything like that because really it doesn't make any sense, honestly. I use Markdown because Markdown is a format that you can easily convert into different formats like HTML or PDF, or things like that you can share with other documents and maybe consolidate documents from different repositories and projects, and then create like a massive knowledge collection of documentation that you can share with your team or different stakeholders. Next will be keep close to your code base. What this means is that don't create, like a cool dog, for example, or create a different repository for ADRs or things like that. Keep those together where whatever that is describing is part of the service. For example, if the ADR is applicable to a concrete service, then add the ADR to the maybe a docs folder, or maybe a new ADRs folder, or an architecture decisions folder, or whatever folder you want to call it, whatever convention your team decides to follow, and keep that together with your code base. That way, when you're committing changes, you can refer to the code, to the ADR specifically, and when everything is completed and deployed to production, you can go back and say, hey, this ADR is completed, I'm done with it. And at the same time, if anything changes, if somebody new comes in, a new team member, this person can refer to the documentation and therefore see the ADRs, because those are part of your code base. So there is no need to go back and forth between different repositories, for example. Now, use ADRs as a collaboration tool. Now, the whole point of defining ADRs is, sure, creating documentation, but the idea is that you can share these ADRs from the beginning when they are in proposed state, and then your team can collaborate and discuss with you your own ideas, how they perceive the changes that you're suggesting, and maybe the improvements that you can make, and they can suggest and collaborate in that way. It's not something that you are enforcing or telling everybody, hey, this is how we're going to be doing it. It's more like, hey, this is how I think this could be done. Does anyone have any ideas to improve what I thought? And maybe I'm missing some other things that you are maybe familiar with. This is a great tool. I use it with my team, and it works format. It works amazingly. So give it a try. Next will be, not everything needs ADRs. And what that I'm trying to say is that, obviously, if you're trying to maybe change the column type of a database table, you don't need to create an ADR. That's not the whole point. This is for big, remember, something that could affect the architecture of your system, something that it could be costly and hard to implement, or will take some time, and something that perhaps you are not too familiar with. So just keep that in mind. I know in the beginning it could be like, hey, do ADRs for everything, but that's not the case. And that's it. Thank you for watching. Hopefully this makes sense. This is one of those videos where I'm covering documentation, but I think the whole point of defining ADRs or architecture decision records is to create, sure, documentation of why we decided to do something, but also at the same time, get your team involved, discuss with your stakeholders if needed, and come up with an idea, with a plan, how to improve the system that you have, and have different eyeballs that they can look at what you decided to do, what you're proposing, and then at the same time, make sure that everybody is on the same page, everybody is aware of the things that could go wrong, and why we're making those decisions. And that's it. Like I said, thank you for watching. I will talk to you next time. Stay safe. Take care. See you.